Who killed Jimmy Mubenga? G4S killed Jimmy Mubenga. Who killed Jimmy Mubenga?
G4S.
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 Jimmy Mubenga.
Justice now.
Jimmy Mubenga.
Justice now.
Rubel Ahmed.
Justice now.
Rubel Ahmed.
Justice now.
Jackie Nanyonjo.
Justice now.
Jackie Nanyonjo.
Justice now.
What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
What do we want?
Justice.
When do we want it?
Now.
No justice.
No peace.
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 I wrote this poem in response to my mother's story coming to the UK as a migrant, and that her generation of Caribbean migrants to the UK. It's called Redefining History. Our parents, our grandparents, came to this country and in half a century redefined Britain's history. Arriving by ship enthusiastically, we were greeted by the mist and the grey of the sea. The bitter cold of the winter season was nothing compared to the ice-cold freezing attitude of those in this country full of hatred and hostility. Greeted by signs of keep Britain white, we'd come unprepared for a fight. No dogs, no Irish, no blacks. We had to always watch our backs. We were told this was the mother country. What mother uses terms that are derogatory? What kind of mother rejects and sets out to inject a sense of worthlessness within the child she should caress? For 50 years we've struggled and fought, sometimes defiant, sometimes distraught, to make a place and be accepted as young, or old and black and gifted. And look what we've achieved despite having to live aggrieved. We built and developed the NHS, made London Transport one of the best, established a carnival while we were oppressed, that's now renowned as Europe's largest. Facing fascism and humiliation, tackling racism and discrimination. Just look what we've achieved despite having to live aggrieved. We've excelled within this land that refused a helping hand in spreading the word of the Holy Scriptures, in trade unions and in literature, in sports and politics, in broadcasting and music, in entertainment and education. We helped empower this nation. Despite the fact we were deceived, we came and we achieved. Our parents, our grandparents came to this country and in half a century redefined Britain's history. Redefined Britain's history. Solidarity. Well done to the organisers today.
My name's Endy McKay. I'm here because I have to be here, really. I'm just like most people that are here, fed up, and feel like we have to be on this. We have to move forward now and stand up against what's going on. That's why I'm here. I think what I feel optimistic about is those of us that know, you know, police brutality and injustice within the system has been going on for years, and it's finally kind of emerging into the spotlight, into the mainstream spotlight. And I think we need to just run with that, because there's too many of these stories. It's ridiculous now, and something needs to be done. So I'm here hoping that we can make big steps through small steps.
What do you think can be achieved by protesting?
It's difficult because I think so much is governed by the media, so you can do a lot of things and it really receive very little press. But I think because of things like Twitter, hashtags, there is a bit of a movement, there's a bit of the ball's rolling a bit. So I'm hoping that just protesting is just, again, wakening up people's consciousness. hopefully it will obviously go towards change. All I know is that sitting at home watching X Factor, sure ain't gonna do nothing, so here we are. I think we have to protest. We can't riot, because that's just gonna, I think personally, that would be it. That would play into the hand, that, you know, that would be locked down. I think that would be not a clever move. Personally, I'm also for peaceful protests, so I wouldn't want to be involved in anything that doesn't promote that. I can see the frustration, because people turn up for things over and over again and they don't see change. It is frustrating, but I just think that persistence, we have to keep going with it. But yeah, if there is other alternative measures, let's talk about them. I'd like to hear about what's going on other than protesting. I'd definitely be up for hearing that.
Detention centres!
Shut them down!
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 Money for jobs and education!
No for racist deportation!
Money for jobs and education!
No for racist deportation!
Asylum seekers have the right!
He had to stay, he had to fight!
Asylum seekers have the right!
He had to stay, he had to fight!
Migrant workers have the right!
He had to stay, he had to fight!
Jimmy Mubenga, justice now! Jimmy Mubenga!
Justice now!
Jimmy Mubenga!
Justice now!
Jackie Nanyanjo!
Justice now!
Jackie Nanyanjo!
Justice now!
Four people result in the death of this gentleman. Four people are responsible for this man dying, and somehow a jury acquitted him of all charges. So, obviously, they didn't kill him, he killed himself. Just like out in Ferguson when, who's a man named Eric Garner, you know, the six police officers that choked him out, they didn't kill him, you know, he killed himself, yeah? Michael Brown in Ferguson, he obviously shot himself. And so I just came down because I didn't go to the demonstration last week down at Westfield. But I said to myself, you know, this is ridiculous. So I just came down just to, you know, just to voice my concerns and my opinions, really.
I give credit to you guys for coming out tonight because it's cold. And give credit to the guys who organized. And I give credit to the man for letting me speak. But the level of anger that you need at a demonstration, if you're going to get any change out of it, you need to be a little bit more hot. I know it's cold out here, but you need to be hot. Because there's no way on this earth, on this day, in this time, this system, which is run from here, is going to listen to you if you're being all well behaved. I'm not saying go out and break the law, because I know the police are here watching me. So I'm not saying that, officer. Yeah? I got you, don't worry. I got you. I got to mind my P's and my Q's. But as citizens of a so-called democratic society, we do have certain rights. And as you see this country moving further and further to the right, not towards righteousness, towards the right, where you can, in 2014, after the madness that we've seen in Ferguson, we can get a jury that can acquit four people, no charges. People need to get more and more angry. If you leave this place today and you just go back to the system and being the same tool and the same fool, I guarantee you, as day follows night and as night follows day, you'll be out here next year protesting something else. And the final point, just to finish, the amount of people that work in this place that I see that are African, African Caribbean, Asian, and I'm thinking, wow, what level of Stockholm syndrome are these people going through that they're just gonna be content to push pens to collect a check? At some point, we need to talk to our brothers and sisters who are in there, and I'm talking to the white people here as well. I'm not talking to the brothers and sisters, I'm talking to everyone here. At some point, we need to start holding our people to account and saying, yo, what degree of consciousness are you dealing with that you can just go clock in, clock out, watch X Factor, watch some Premier League football and go about your business? So to conclude, if there's no justice, there can be no
peace.
If there can be no justice, there's no
peace.
If there's no justice, there's no what?
Peace.
No justice, no what?
This is going to be a demonstration of a injustice on a humongous scale, you know, massive injustice. And people were talking to them, you know, and making little political speeches, sound like they was reading out their dissertation from university. And you're like, hold on a sec. A man's dead, 5 children have been robbed of their father. A wife has been robbed of her husband, and people are here talking like it's some academic exercise. It's not, this is serious stuff, you know? And I just felt that it needed that perspective of somebody. So the first thing I said was how many people here have been in a police chokehold? Put your hands up. And one of the things that you realize is a lot of the guys that are demonstrating, they're demonstrating from a very kind of abstract perspective. You know, he who feels it knows it. So when I saw Eric Garner, for example, and it's on YouTube, and you can see the man getting choked out, I know what it's like to be in a police chokehold. You know, I know what it's like to have a police put his hand like this, and you can't breathe. And they threw me on the floor, and the weight of the policeman was on me. And so not only is his weight on my chest so I can't breathe, he's also got me in this hold. And I'm thinking, I'm gonna die here. This man is looking to kill me. And luckily, I managed to put my head at a 90 degree angle like this, which then freed my windpipe so I could just manage to still breathe. Because that man was looking to choke the shit out of me. So when you see a brother in a chokehold, I know what it's like to be in a chokehold. And it's not nice. It's not nice. So I just had to make sure to the people that came down, do you know what it's like? Do you really know what it's like? And you saw a couple of black hands go up, a couple brothers, and you're okay, yeah, here we are. And it really, for me, it just kind of puts it that we are like a hunted species. We're not an endangered species, but we're a hunted species. You know, be it New York, be it Missouri, be it London, you know, be it Brixton, wherever they got these policing and the black man, and we come into contact like this, you know, we often come off second best and we don't get any justice. Mm. It's just us getting served up, but we don't get no justice.
Until there is justice, there will be
no peace.
Until there is justice, there will be
no peace.
Money for jobs and education.
No more racist people ever.
Money for jobs and education.
No more racist people ever.
Money for jobs and education.
No more racist.
We're here outside the G4S offices in Victoria. Could you tell us who you are, what you're doing here, and basically what do you expect to happen?
My name is Lester Holloway. I'm a journalist, equality activist, and a broadcaster with Ben TV. I'm here because, like everyone behind me, totally disgusted with the court verdict letting off 3 G4S employees. This is the G4S headquarters just behind me in Victoria Street, London. And Jimmy Mubenga was being deported to Angola, was being put in a position on the plane which was inevitably going to lead to either serious injury or death. And the court heard that over 20 witnesses on the plane were saying that Jimmy Mubenga was saying he could not breathe. Yet the G4S employees clearly ignored this, and for me the decision of the court was completely perverse, that it was flew well in the face of the evidence that there was serious questions to be answered, if not guilt. And I'm just sick and tired of these cases. We had verdict in the case of Mark Duggan recently, where all the evidence was pointing to some serious questions with the police before they shot Mark Duggan. He clearly didn't have a gun in his hand at the time when he was shot. Yet the courts found in favour of the police. And you know, how long are we going to go on where, you know, so much evidence is pointing to you know, the way in which, you know, our sisters and brothers are being killed, but yet nobody is held to account. These people, the police, security guards, immigration officers, are not above the law. We have one law for everyone. And if we have equality in Britain, then everyone should be treated equally. So that's why I'm here.
The link between black people not voting and black people not protesting is like this. It's like this. Because if you vote and the majority of people in this country who are eligible to vote still vote, yeah, the numbers are decreasing, but they still vote, right? So the election time, the politicians who start talking this talk to try and get the votes from the people, they got to come with a certain type of talk because they want to get the votes. Now, if you get one set of politicians that are talking this right wing, we got to clamp down on immigration, we got to do this, we got to do that, and they're talking to, you know, Terry from Essex or whoever, the white van man. I'm not knocking white van drivers because I know quite a few of them, but I'm just using it as an example. If they know that that's what those voters are tuning into, that's the talk I'm going to give them. And unfortunately, because our people are very, very bad at articulating the hurt that we have, you know, very, very bad. So people don't actually realise the pain that we're in. And we're so disempowered that we think that if we don't vote, it makes no difference. Because we say, well, whatever politician gets elected, he don't represent us, so I'm not voting. Okay, so you've delinked from that part of your responsibility. So then the other part is that if you don't do it that way, then do it this way. Take it to the street if that's what you're gonna do. Either do it the high way or do it the low way, but do it some way. So if you don't do it at the ballot box, you do it by protesting. And if you ain't even protesting, nor are you voting, then all you've done is that you've castrated yourself. You have done to yourself, by your limited mindset, exactly what the KKK and these people did to black people over the past 100 years or so, when black people stood up and said, you know what, I'm gonna go and vote. You know what, I'm gonna go and protest. So they used to brutalize us to keep us in check. Now we keep ourselves in check, all by ourselves.
The Westfield protest, there was like 10 times the amount of people that we have out here. Do black lives in the US matter more than black lives in the UK?
You know what? I could give a sort of instant opinion to that, Christopher, but I just it's a difficult one to answer. I'll tell you why I'm sort of having difficulties with this question. Is because, you know, my gut is saying that, you know, we hear a lot about cases in the, you know, in the US, and you know, that has a worldwide impact, but yet we don't really, America and Black America doesn't really hear about our situations over there. And sometimes we do have this disconnect. I mean, we have very little information about the protests that went on in Paris just last week and the week before as well, where Black Parisians were protesting about Exhibit B, the racist exhibition by the white South African Brett Bailey. So, I mean, all black lives matter, you know, all lives matter per se, but it's, you know, I don't know, we just need to, you know, we're one diaspora, one people. The Honourable Marcus Messiah Garvey always quoted the overall number of Africans in the world whenever he made a speech. He was all including us as one, and sometimes we kind of forget that. Sometimes we forget about the people in Bristol or Birmingham or Manchester or Sheffield or Cardiff wherever it is. And you know, as I said, we got the power in our hands. I know Twitter and Facebook is not owned by us, but you know, it's there. And until we have a black Twitter and a black Facebook rather than just the hashtag, then let's use what's before us. And if they, you know, if some people are monitoring us, then fine. You know, at least they know that we're on their case.
What happened with Michael Brown was the media hype behind it, the social media hype behind it. What happened here today with the protest of Jimmy Mubenga, I think the way it was played, it was kept low-key to a certain extent. And the whole thing with the hip-hop artists in the United States, people like J. Cole and these people getting involved in the protest, Talib Kweli going down to Ferguson, they've got the young people politicized. And over here, our grime artists over here never picked up on the Jimmy Mubenga story. So it never resonated within a section of young people. I guarantee if you go to any young black man down in South London, 19 years old, 20 years old, say to him, you hear about Eric Gardner? He'll be like, yeah, for real. So you hear about Jimmy Mubenga? Jimmy who? Was he that football player that had a heart attack? They don't know. Because the channels of communication, the hip-hop boys and the grime artists that really should be like the griots of our community, putting that information out there, they're not doing their job because they live in that bubble. So, you know, so what they talk about, what they rap about is a reality, but it's an artificial reality. To the griots out there, the so-called grime MCs, the MCs out there, griots. For those of you who don't know, the griot was like the CNN of the traditional African community. Yeah, he kept the history and he was a vocal person. Griot, G-R-I-O-T, griot. Acronym means give right information on time. And for you grime MCs, what you're spitting at the moment is not the right information and it's the wrong time. So you're so out of sync with what's really going on with amongst our people that you become quite irrelevant. And what happens is that your message, being a message of, you know, materialism and nihilism and self-hatred, is what is perpetrated. If you as a grime MC started spitting lifetime bars for the people, started breaking down the connection between what happens in Ferguson and what happens in down here at the Home Office, if you can make that connection, then trust me, when you start putting your bars out there, you'll get a different response. You might not get played on One Extra or Capital Extra. You might not get called to, you know, open the school fete. But what you will do is that you have peace of mind. It's called freedom, and you speak the truth in regards to whom or what. And guaranteed you do that, and there will be people on the block level that will love what you say, and they'll love you for it. But you just got to be brave enough to stand up and speak the truth. And stop all this foolishness. Stop talking about killing niggers. Stop it, it's done. That's not your job. No, that's the KKK's job. That's the BNP's job. Why are you doing their job for? Are they paying you to do that stuff? And if they're not paying you to do that stuff, then you're nothing but a modern day 21st century slave. You're not even getting paid. That's what I don't understand about it. You bad. On behind the mic, you're bad for another black man that looks just like you, that comes out the same conditions as you, is the same age as you, wears the same clothes as you, eats the same food as you, is going through the same struggle as you. You're bad for him. But then the man who's the puppet master, who pulls his system and makes it all fit together, you don't say boo to him. You don't say a damn thing. That's the trouble. That's the trouble. And because you have so much influence, you spread a fantasy. It's not a reality, it's a fantasy that you're spreading amongst impressionable young minds who then pick up on your bullshit and start to replicate it. So then what you have is a knock-on effect. So the madness of our young people is just going down and down and down and down and down to generations. And you're thinking, what is these youths onto? It's time to wake up, people. Time to wake up. Rashid Nix, parliamentary candidate, Dulwich and West Norwood, 2015. Peace.